Good morning. My favorite Edgemont people are here, so we can start now, right? Don't tell the rest of Edgemont, in case, because I'm sure there's other really nice people there. Okay. It is a joy to gather together for worship today. You might have noticed on the front of your bulletin, there's an extra little logo there. Yeah, that doesn't show up on the computer screen, but it shows up when you print. So I have two theories. One is the devil is in the computer, which I believe strongly, and likes to mess with your head. And when you work on this for a half hour trying to get rid of that, I believe that's true. The other theory is that God is in the printer. And he really wanted us to remember that today is the first Sunday in February, and our new mission of the month starts today, and our mission of the month is Youth and Family Services in Rapid City, which works really well with our mission as a congregation in helping children and families. So I think that's why it shows up when it's printed, as an extra reminder that our globe offering and our mission of the month for this month will go to Youth and Family Services. But you might have also noticed we're having a little friendly competition here. And in case you missed it, the Falcons seem to be in the lead. So if you brought soup today for our Super Bowl Sunday, you are welcome to bring it up at any time or during offering. And we'll see at the end of the day which team this congregation thinks might win the game. Now, if you forgot your soup, but would like to make a contribution to the food bank and or helping to determine which team will win, you are welcome at offering time or during communion to put money in one of the soup pots. All of the money in the soup pot will go to our local food bank, but during the last hymn, I will try to do a quick count and let you know where we stand at that time. And then if you still don't like the outcome, before you leave, you can quick stick some more money, and I'll announce it next week as well as later on today on Facebook what our congregation decided is the possible outcome of the Super Bowl. Did that answer your question? I forgot your team? Well, your team's not playing then. The Clydesdales. Next year we'll have to add the Clydesdales team. They would be the winners by far, though.
Absolutely.
Yep. The Clydesdales, unless they bring the Bullfrogs back. Who remembers the Budweiser Bullfrogs? Okay, I'm not alone, right? I don't drink beer, but Budweiser has the best commercials. That's all there is to it. So, with that being stated, other announcements are in your bulletin. Let us take a moment to breathe in and breathe out and welcome. Welcome the Holy Spirit and God as we join together in worship. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nation, who gives breath to us all. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start. so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another. I invite you to return to your seats as we sing together hymn number 673. Please rise as you are able. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
This is the feast of victory for our God.
Let us pray. Lord God, with endless mercy, you receive the prayers of all who call upon you. By your Spirit, show us the things we ought to do, and give us the grace and power to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, I shall read from Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 12, and I'll do the regular print and you do the bold as we've been doing. Shout out.
Can you go a little closer?
Okay. Oh, how about right here? Shout out. Do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke?
Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin.
Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard.
Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer you. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am."
If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday.
The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places, and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a water garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail.
Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You should be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise.
Our gospel reading is from Matthew. We continue in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until it is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The word of the Lord. Please be seated as we sing together this little light of mine, and I invite the children to come forward for the children's time. Thank you. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Come over here. I'm gonna let it shine. This, come sit right here. Come down. Thank you. Shine, let it shine. Thanks for coming up today. I appreciate it. So the song, This Little Light of Mine, did you just listen to the Bible verses I read? Kind of sound familiar? Like maybe it was written based on those verses, right? I happen to really like light. How about you guys? I'm not such a big fan of darkness. Put me in a dark room and I will panic pretty quickly. So I got this light as a graduation gift from seminary. And I don't know if you can see it, but it has love, hope, joy all over it. And when I turn it on, it's just this really pretty light that lights up the room and helps me not to be afraid. So I thought I would turn it on and show you guys. It's not working. What? Oh, you're right. It's not plugged in. Oops. So a light needs power to shine, right? So if I would plug it in to the handy dandy outlet that I happen to have right here, and I try again. The light comes on and it shines in the darkness and it helps me not to be afraid and settles me down and helps to keep me calm. It also reminds me of the wonderful person who gave this to me, who happens to also be a pastor and a mom in Minnesota. And it helps me to remember that God is with me in the darkness. So we're supposed to let our light shine, right? But we need to plug into a power too. We can't do it by ourselves. So who's our power that we plug into? God. Excellent. See, I have future pastors sitting right here. Okay? So we plug into God because we need God in order for our light to shine. So I was trying to think of different ways that maybe your light has shined this week. And somebody, and I won't name names this morning, thought maybe we should move all of the food from the Falcon side to the Patriot side. Would that be a good way of letting our light shine? Not so much, right? Yeah, that is not a good reflection of who we are as Christians. How about if we moved everything from the Patriot side to the Falcon side? That'd be good? That'd be okay? Okay, let's think about that for just a minute. Even though we might want the Falcons to win, I'm not so sure God thinks it's about winning and losing, but maybe more about how we play the game, right? It's kind of a cliche, but it's truth. We want to have fun and do our best all the time so that God's light can shine through us to others, just like this light shines, right? Thanks for coming up and having some fun with me today. I appreciate it. Let's say a prayer. God, help our lights to shine no matter what we're doing. But more importantly, God, help our lights to shine so others can see you and the love and grace and mercy that you offer to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I've got candy to get rid of, so I'm thinking maybe 3 pieces of candy today. Yeah? Okay. Help yourselves. shine everywhere I go. I'm gonna let it shine. Go. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and from Jesus the Christ, our Savior. Amen. All right. I want you to say this with me. Ready? We are the best of the best of the best. And those who have been here following our sermon series, can you fill in those who might be worshiping for new today with us why we are the best of the best of the best? How do I know that? Because we're disciples. Thank you, Marv. You get an A and a gold star for today. One person has been listening. We are disciples of God, and rabbis only choose the best of the best of the best to follow them. So therefore, I know that we are the best of the best of the best. Okay, how about this one? Speak. We are blessed. And as we learned last week in looking at the Beatitudes, we may not be blessed in ways that our world sees that we are blessed, but we are blessed in ways that God sees we are blessed. I have another one for you. Thanks to my daughter who sent this to me this morning, my morning, her last night. Who gets it? I think you are fantastic, which is another true statement. I think you are, and God thinks you are. And today, as we continue listening in, as Jesus instructs his disciples on the mountain, we hear these words. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. These references have a way deeper meaning to Jesus' disciples than we might realize. When Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth," he is taking the disciples back to a time long before that they are born. This isn't the first time in Jewish literature that salt of the earth has been used. In around 720-something B.C., the Jews were sent into exile by the Assyrians. They were dispersed around the entire, in their minds, world, because that's all the bigger the world was to them at that time. They were forced out of their community, away from their temples. They were forced to live in and assimilate with the communities around them. Not together as a people, but individual and separate from everything they knew and every way that they knew how to survive. That is what the king at that time did. And it was either disperse or be killed. But the Jews knew and lived the Torah. So even long after the Torah had no longer been taught because it was illegal to teach it at that time. There was no rabbi in the community. There was no place to gather. Even long after the Torah had been taught, the laws and the rituals and the traditions were still there, and they were still being followed, even subconsciously. The Jews that had been dispersed at that time were continuing to be salt of the earth, preserving the Hebrew Bible, the Torah, the faith, the laws, the rituals, the way of being people of God. You are the salt of the earth. What we do, how we are, matters, because we preserve our faith so that others can see the light of Christ, the love of God, so that it can be spread and it can grow, and those who are outside can be welcomed in to the community of disciples, of believers, of people who have been redeemed and loved by God. Did you notice that nowhere in Scripture does Jesus say you should, or you will be, or you could be, or you might be, or in the future if you do this? He proclaims to the disciples here and now and present, you are the salt of the earth. And then he goes on to proclaim, you are the light of the world. For us, in our baptisms, we are named and claimed and redeemed by God. We are given a candle, and it is proclaimed to us, let your light so shine in the darkness that others may see your good works and give glory to the Father. And I've preached this before, but I'm going to say it again. It's not about bringing glory to us. It's about pointing to the cross and bringing glory to God. And again, it's not even as a tiny baby, it's not you might be, you will be, you could be, or in the future you're going to be. Even as a tiny baby, it's a declaration of you are in the here and in the now. No matter your age, your race, your gender, you are the light of the world. And guess what? We can hear those things and we can believe those things. We can be taught those things and we can learn those things. But if that knowledge stays up here and doesn't transfer through and out of us, what good is it? This is a promise. You are. But it is also a call to action. Because unless we put these things into action, we cannot be disciples of God. Because we cannot allow others to learn about who this God is and to be freed from all the weight that they carry. What you may not know is in the social media world of pastors right now, there is a whole lot of conversation happening about what does it look like to be the salt and the light, to bless and be blessed, to be the best of the best of the best. And this might not surprise you, but we can't seem to agree. I know, you're probably shocked. A whole bunch of pastors get together and they can't agree. Big shock. It's kind of like all of us getting together and trying to agree that we should all do the same thing. That will never happen. It'd be like getting your family all together and trying to agree you should all do the same thing. Have you ever tried to plan a family reunion? It's not going to happen. We are all going to agree to disagree on exactly what it looks like to be salt and light. However, in his continued teaching, in his continued way that Jesus points us back to the Hebrew Bible, to the Old Testament, Jesus continues to give us some guidance. And he says, I didn't come to abolish the law. I didn't come to abolish the commandments. We need order. We need structure. We need a way to live. We've got the Ten Commandments, most importantly. We've got the most important commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, and love your neighbors as yourselves. So what does it look like to be salt and light? A couple of weeks ago, we looked at this text from Micah. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? That's what it looks like to be salt and light. Our text from Isaiah preaches the same thing to us. This is the same thing that Jesus would have been referring back to. The people are fasting and they're trying to do all these great things, but they're not doing it with the right heart. They're doing it so that people pay attention to them, and they don't understand why God's not paying attention to them. And God says, you're doing it wrong. You're doing it for the wrong reasons. Is not this the fast I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? And when you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourselves from your own kin? Then your light shall shine forth in the darkness. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually. That's the challenge for us. That's the challenge for us as a family who maybe doesn't always agree about the specifics and the details. That's my challenge as a pastor who feels called to proclaim and to use my voice for good, but is not sure how to go about doing that in today's world with today's conflicts. That is our challenge, is to determine how the Lord is guiding us to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly as God with God. That is our challenge, is to figure out how it is that God is calling us to be salt, whether it is to make something taste better or be better, whether it is to melt the hearts of those who are hardened, whether it is to create something good out of something you wouldn't want to eat plain, like the rock salt you put with the ice cream, whether it's to allow our light to shine in a single room or to brighten an entire community. We have been called as disciples of Christ not just to learn about God, but to be the face of God and the hands and feet of God. So I ask you, this past week, how have you been light and salt? Because I know you have. I know there are prayers in this congregation. I know there are people who have lent a helping hand, who have offered a smile, who have opened a door, who have hugged a child or another adult just because they needed a hug. I know there are people in this congregation who have been fantastic role models for those around them. And I know that God is calling us to continue to look for ways to bring the kingdom of God here. How have others been salt and light for you? What kind word has been spoken that has brightened your day, a phone call that's been made, or even just being able to get out of bed in the morning, put on clothes, maybe take a shower, head outside to the world, because somebody else offered a prayer for you because you really needed it. We are the salt and the light. We are disciples of God who bring about the kingdom of God right here and right now. May God continually guide you this week as you take what you have learned and put it into action and allow God's light to shine in a world that desperately needs it. Amen. Please rise as we sing number 712 together. Number 712, Lord, Whose Love and Humble Service. Journeying together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Called to be a light to the nations. Let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. Eternal God, you are three in one, and one in three. Strengthen the ministry of the World Council of Churches and the Lutheran World Federation. Solidify ecumenical partnerships as they work to break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Hear us, O God. Send relief where storms and floods overwhelm. Provide shelter and safe habitat for all creatures. Protect seeds and bulbs for the spring and fall harvest. Let us pray. Ignite the nations with the flame of your justice. Enlighten the leaders of the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank with your wisdom. Guide government officials to seek economic justice in their communities. Let us pray. Comfort the afflicted, compassionate God. Accompany all who wait on death row. Reconcile families torn apart by crime or addiction. Heal the brokenhearted, the newly diagnosed, and all who suffer, including Lyle and Vero, Claire and Esther, Jerry and Susan, Cindy and Heather, Don and Danita, and Jessica and Fred. Let us pray. Fill those who form the faith of others with insight and energy. Multiply the fruit of their labor. Grow disciples eager to feast on your living word and embody it each day. Let us pray. We thank you for all the saints who dare to shine with the light of Christ. Compel us to shine freely and witness to your abundant grace each day. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is the one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. As we gather together our offering, I thank you for your generosity. It's not the Vikings either. I love it. Please rise.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts towards those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. This meal has truly been prepared by Jesus Christ, and all are welcome to take and eat and taste and see that the Lord is good. I think today we will do continuous communion. We're going to start on this side and come down, but start on this side, but form the line on this side, so that when you come through, you can head right back to your seats, and we'll do a blessing at the end. And after we're done singing Lamb of God, there is a song that's been running through my head this week, and so it's going to be played on the screen. After you receive communion, and as you're receiving communion, for many people, it's a time of kind of prayer and reflection, and so may this song be my prayer for you. Communion servers, please come forward.
Instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase.
Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing together hymn number 314, Arise, Your Light Has Come. Well, I'm not sure what this means. It might be a tie because the Falcons obviously have more soup and the Patriots have less. But the Falcons have $25 in their pot and the Patriots have $65 in their pot. So it is a win-win all the way around. So as of right now, I declare it a tie. Go in peace, serve the Lord.